Hello everyone. In this lecture, we'll be studying design of columns for the third year students, and the subject is structural design and drawing 1. Following are the topics that we'll be covering: design of axially loaded short columns, design of uniaxial short columns, and design of biaxial short columns. Let's begin. Okay, so as we all know that column is a compression member. We have discussed in our previous classes that what does a compression member means, what does a tension member means. So from the previous knowledge, we can come to the conclusion that column is a compression member. Now, how do we define that according to the ratio of its dimension, that whether it's a column or not? So basically, anything which is standing along the length doesn't mean it's a column. It according to the ratio of its effective length and the lateral dimension, we can the member behave in a certain way. Okay, so that behavior is a behavior of a compression member if the dimensions are in a certain pattern. So let us have a look. L, effective length divided by least lateral dimension, should be greater than 3. Then and then only we'll consider it as a column. Okay. So if effective length divided by least lateral dimension is less than 3, we'll consider it as a pedestal, not a column, but a pedestal. Okay. Now, if it's a column and effective length by least lateral dimension is less than 12, it is considered to be a short column. Greater than 12, it's a long column. Long column or a slender column. So slender by itself means that length will be much, much larger compared to its least lateral dimension. It will look quite slender. So the failure will be because of buckling. Okay. So these are the definitions of columns, when to classify it as a short column and when to classify it as a long column, and these are under the guidelines of IS 456. Now, to design any member, we have seen that we have to understand the load coming on it. With the pattern of load coming on it, we can decide the behavior of it, like how that member is going to deflect, or how it is going to buckle, or how is it going to fail. If we know that pattern, we can design it. So what are the various loads acting on a column, and how does the various loads get transferred to a column? Okay. So for this first figure, I have just drawn a beam and these are the end columns. Now what happens here is, this is the reaction, this is the beam, and these arrow, as we see, we have solved a beam number of times and we know these are the reactions of the beam. So these reactions are the axial force which is acting on the column. So the reaction of the beam act as an axial load for the column, as this reaction is going to get transferred into the column. And also the moment generated at the end because of these reactions. Okay, that we'll study just later. And similarly, in the second diagram, we can again see that this is a beam, and column is above the beam, is above as well as below. So the reaction of the beam is anyway getting transferred in the column, plus there is an axial force which is coming from the upper column. Okay, and this upper column is getting its axial force from the beam attached to it. So this is quite clear that columns get its axial force from the connected beam. Also, column gets its axial force from its self weight itself, and column gets the moment from the moment which is created because of this axial force and the eccentricity. Okay, so column is subjected to axial force from above columns, moment from beams caused by the eccentricity between the load and CG of the column. Okay, so like in this figure, this is the column on which the beam is resting. So if it is resting at exact center, then the CG of your axial force will coincide with the CG of the column. In that case, no eccentricity will be generated and no extra moment will be generated. If exactly at the center no eccentricity, then we go for axial columns, but we have to check for minimum eccentricity, because what is this minimum eccentricity? This minimum eccentricity arises because of construction errors. So having a purely axially loaded column is not technically possible, so we have to check for minimum eccentricity. Now in the second figure, the beam is not resting directly at the center, so the load is at a distance E from the CG of column. So this P into this E eccentricity is generating a moment which is transferred into the column, P into E. Okay, it can be from both the directions or it can be from one direction. If it is from both the directions, then we are telling it, then it is a biaxial column, and if it is from one direction, it's a uniaxial column. Okay, now we'll calculate this P into E and you'll calculate P into minimum eccentricity. So if we are having RP into E greater than that of the minimum eccentricity, in that case we go for design of moment for moments as well. Otherwise we design an totally axially column. Okay. Okay. So we have seen this effective length. We have studied it in strength of materials as well. We'll just brush it up. Okay. We can find out the effective length for the for our column based on different end conditions. Okay, table 28 in IS 456 states various end conditions. Also, we can find out the buckling load by this formula. We have seen this formula in strength of materials as well. And L, where it is the effective length. So, this is the total load that a column can carry before buckling or crippling. So, L is the effective length. How do we find the L? In IS 456 table 12, depending on the end conditions, these are the values. So there is one theoretical value and a recommended value. So we'll always go for a recommended value of 0.65L, 0.8L, depending on the end conditions given in our question. Okay. Also the slenderness limit, like how slender a column can be. Okay, while designing or while defining the dimensions, how slender you can go. So, the code limits it in clause 25.3 that unsupported length should not be greater than 60 times of least lateral dimension. So, each time when we go for design of a slender column or we design a slender column by fixing its dimensions, we have to take care about this criteria. Also, if one end is restrained, so L should not be, effective length should not be greater than 100 D square by D. Okay, what is restrained and unrestrained? I think we have studied it before. And also in this table, it will be clear, the effectively held or it is hinged. Okay. Now, I think this point is very important to understand that, let's look at the first figure in x direction. Okay, this is the column and there is a beam passing through it in the x direction. Similarly, in the y direction, there is a column and the beam is passing through it in the y direction. This is the x direction if we right now, and this is the y direction. So, there is a beam in both the directions of the column, x as well as y. Okay. So, a plan looks like this is the column and beam is coming from all four sides, and similarly in this, beam is coming from all four sides. That means the column is restrained in both the directions. It's tied in both the directions. Okay, the column is tied in both the directions, basically not restrained. So it is tied in both the directions. Why does it matter that column should be tied in both the directions or in any one of the directions? That we'll have a look. So right now, for this figure, effective length in x is effective length in y because column is tied in x direction as well as y direction. Tied means beam is resting over there. So its length is breaking there. Okay. Now we'll go for this figure. In x direction, we can see again beam is passing in both the directions, but at the same level in y, there is no beam. Okay. As there is no beam over here, the effective length is not breaking. And effective length in y direction is is going to be higher than effective length in x direction. Kyunki x mein toh there is a beam which is crossing, but by y mein there is no beam. Okay. So just imagine in x side, say there is a beam. So, if the floor is of 3 meters, 3 meters. So if there is a beam between floor 1 and floor 2, so the effective length becomes 3 meters. Okay. And if there is no floor between, no beam in the y direction, there is no beam. So in the y direction, the same column have its effective length of 6 meters. This is very important to understand because L effective plays a very important role. We'll move forward. So this is explained over here, like this is the roof. For the first floor, fourth floor we have the beam, so L effective is X. Between the fourth floor and the second floor, at the third floor, we are not having the beam. So the effective length is 2X. Again, between the second floor and the first floor, we have the beam. So effective length becomes X. Okay. Now we'll go criteria of minimum eccentricity. We have the L minimum eccentricity shall be calculated by this criteria. And it is given in IS 456 clause 25.4. Okay, so we have seen that columns can be of three types. While designing, we have to take care of the column should be axially loaded short column, only subjected to axial force. It can be a uniaxial column subjected to axial force and moment from one direction. It can be a biaxial column having an axial force and moment from both the directions. We'll start with axially loaded column. So design of axially loaded short column. Question is, design a column 4 meter long, restrained in position and direction at both ends to carry an axial load of 1600 kN. We'll use M20 Fe415. We'll start designing. So length is given 4 meters. As the both ends are fixed, we'll refer table 28 to find L effective, which is 0.65 L. 0.65 into 4 is 2.6 meters. So our effective length is now 2.6 meters. Okay. Load was given 1600, but we'll factor it to find the ultimate load, which is 2400 kN. Now, in designing the column, we have to assume some percentage of steel. Okay, how we are assuming 1% and why are we only assuming 1% is because according to code, minimum amount of steel which you can provide is 0.8% and maximum it can go to 4% or 6%. We generally don't go for 6% because it causes a lot of congestion. And proper concreting cannot be done. Also, we avoid 4% as well because that is also creating problem in tying of bars. So, we'll just restrict to 2.5%. Practically, I'm talking. But theoretically, if you go by the code, you can design up to 4%. Okay. And as 0.8 is the minimum percentage of steel, we are assuming 1% right now. If our section passes for the 1%, it's good, or we'll increase the percentage of steel and design again. Okay, so if we go for 1% steel, we get area of only concrete becomes 99% of gross area. Okay, one thing is gross area, that is the total area of your column. If it is of 300 by 400, it is 12,000 is the total area of your column. And 1% steel, so 99% is area of concrete, 1% is area of steel, and 100% is your gross area. So your area of steel is 1% of your gross area. Okay. So we have a formula right here. Right here you can see in clause 39.3 of IS 456. So you can calculate the AG or the gross area, because you don't know the gross area in the question. Rest everything you know. So we know P, which is 2400 into 1000 is for converting it into Newton. 0.4 FCK is 20. 99% of gross area is area of concrete, and 0.67 Fy415, and 1% of gross area is area of steel. Okay. So we found out that 224288 mm² is going to be your gross area. Okay. Now you can go for a square column or rectangular column. Right now we are going for a square column, so we'll under root it. And we can say that 474 mm is one dimension of your column, lateral dimension. So we'll take around 500, because we know we have to round it off. We cannot take absurd numbers where size is concerned. So we'll provide 500 by 500 mm of the column. So right now our column size is fixed of 500 by 500 mm with 1% of steel. This is what we are going to check, that 1600 ke load ke liye 1% steel dete hain. So 500 by 500 ka column is sufficient or not, that we are going to design for. Okay. So, you can refer IS 456 and consider it. Okay. Once we have fixed the dimensions, we are going to check whether the column is slender column or a short column. We have to find that which way we are going to design it. So we'll just check the effective length divided by least lateral dimension. Right now our column is of 500 by 500, so our least lateral dimension is 500. Effective length is 0.65 into L, which was 2600 divided by 500, which is 5.2, which is less than 12. So it's a short column. Okay. Next, we'll check for the minimum eccentricity. Minimum eccentricity L by 500, D by 30 comes out to be 24.67. We'll divide it by E minimum by D. The ratio is less than 0.05. So we'll design it as a actually loaded short column. We are not going to consider the eccentricity and we are not going to consider the additional moment. Okay. Now we are going to see longitudinal reinforcement is 1%. We have seen longitudinal reinforcement is 1% of gross AG, which is 1% of 224288, which is 2243 mm square. Okay. If we use 8 bars of 20 mm dia, evenly distributed on all sides, 2243 mm square gets sufficed. So 1% steel was okay. And we have got our longitudinal bars. Now, we have to go for lateral ties. Okay. What is lateral ties like? We used to go for stirrups and beams. So we have to go for lateral ties. Lateral ties is as the word itself says, lateral. So it is avoiding the bars to sway laterally in case of a lateral force as well as in other cases. So how do we design these lateral ties? So in columns, we are not going to call it as stirrups. The stirrups in columns are known as lateral ties. Okay. So dia of lateral ties should not be less than, again this pitch is given in IS 456, least lateral dimension. So right now our least lateral dimension is 500 mm. 16 times smallest diameter of longitudinal reinforcement. Longitudinal reinforcement is of 20 mm and 16 times of 20 is 320 mm or 300 mm whichever is less. So right now 300 mm is the least of all the figures, so we'll provide 8 mm dia lateral tie at 300 center to center. For columns, we can provide lateral ties of 8 mm dia, but the longitudinal bar shall not be less than of 12 mm diameter. Therefore, we'll never provide 8 mm diameter as a longitudinal bar. We can only provide it as a lateral tie. Okay. So here we are complete this design and we have these 8 bars, and which is tied by these longitudinal lateral ties at every 300 mm. Okay, this is the plan and this is the section. Okay, so sometimes this may happen that you are given the load, right? In this case, you are given the load. Sometimes they can give you area of your column, and they can ask that this is the percentage of steel and tell us that how much amount of load it is going to carry. So in that case, you have to put that formula and find out P. Okay, very easy. Short column subjected to only axial load is very easy. Next, we are going to design uniaxial column. So, now we are having two forces to deal with. One is the axial load and second is the uniaxial moment, that is moment from any one of the direction, either mx or my. Okay, this is basically a graph or the curve which a compression member follow. So this is between mu by, that is the moment by fck bd square, and this is between your axial load which is coming on the column by fck bd square. A is when your column is subjected to pure moment, and the failure of the column occurs, compression failure occur from point B to point C. This is in this zone compression failure is going to occur. So when our column is going to lie, we are designing for the time when our column is going to lie in this compression failure. So for that, now we have to refer SP16. SP16 is a design aid. Okay, there are graphs in FCC, and this is the graph for P by FCK. So whenever your P is the percentage of steel, understand it very clearly because these graphs are a little confusing. P is the percentage of steel and FCK is your grade of concrete, is 0.16. So when your P by FCK is 0.16, in that case, when your mu by fck bd square is somewhat this and pu is this, it coincide to give you p by fck of 0.16. And from here, you can find this p, which is your percentage of steel. Okay. So for the given pu, given mu, we are again finding the suitable percentage of steel. So there are various graphs which are plotted between pu by fck bd and mu by fck bd square in SP16 for different values of percentage. Okay. So from chart 39 to 50, when you can download SP16 by PDF, from internet PDF, and from chart 39 to 50 are the charts in which the steel is distributed, the reinforcement is distributed on all four sides of the column evenly. So we'll always try and distribute evenly. So we'll refer the columns for all four sides, distribution of all four sides. Now, various D for various D dash by D. What is D dash by D? D dash is this cover and D is again your lateral dimension. Okay. We'll just solve one question so we'll understand how to use the chart also. A column of size 300 by 400 mm have effective length of 3.6 meters and is subjected to a load of 1100 kilonewton with a moment of 150 kilonewton meter about major axis. Okay. FCK will M25 and FY is 415 with a cover of 60 mm, which means D dash is 60 mm. Okay, we will check first thing. We'll check as we know the dimensions right now. We will check that whether it is a long column or a short column. So L by D, least lateral dimension. Length is 3600 as the length in the question is effective length. We need not to find the effective length right now because the effective length is given, which is 9 less than 12. So, definitely our column is a short column. We'll check for the actual eccentricity. So, see, actual eccentricity is P into E is moment. So, moment by load is going to give you eccentricity, which is coming out to be 136 mm. And minimum eccentricity comes out to be 20.53. You can see the difference. Minimum, if anyway our eccentricity was greater than 20.53, we would have to go for designing for this eccentricity had it been 35. So we will have to multiply P into 35, and then for that eccentricity we have to check whether our column is passing or not. But right now we can see 136 is a huge eccentricity, and we are going to design for this moment only 150. So this is a short column with axial load and a uniaxial bending. Okay. So we have to refer that graph. So on the x-axis of the graph, see, on the x-axis of the graph, I'll show you. You have PU by FCK BD, and on the y-axis you have MU by FCK BD. So you have to find both the values because you have to refer. Okay. So you will find out PU by FCK BD is 1100 into 1000 divided by 25 is FCK, B is 300, D is 400, which comes out to be 0.367. Similarly, we will find MU by FCK BD square. MU is 150 10 raised to power 6 for converting into Newton mm as it was into kilonewton meter, divided by FCK 25, B 300 and D 400 ka square, which is 0.125. Then D dash by D, because you have to find out which chart to refer. Okay. So, chart for D dash by D, 60 by 400, 0.15. So, from the chart, now we'll see how we select the chart. See, D dash by D is 0.15. So, there are various charts have different D dash by D. FY is 415. Okay. In our question, FY is 415. Sometimes your FY can be 500 with a similar D dash by D. So, you go for another chart. We are considering we are going to distribute on all four sides. So, we'll take this chart. There are also charts in which only they are distributed on two sides. Okay. Now, what we are going to do is, see, we have PU by FCK BD 0.367 and MU is 0.125. MU is 0.125, which will be somewhat here. Okay, we'll go direct straight up, and PU was 0.36, which will be somewhat here. Okay, so you go by here 0.36, okay, and 0.15. Wherever you intersect, you have to intersect on this curve, okay, whichever curve you intersect, that is your value for P by FCK, small p by FCK, where P is the percentage of steel. I'll repeat it. For MU by FCK BD square, हमारा आया 0.12. So, हमने 0.12 से हम ऊपर गए. यहां से हम 0.36 से आए और हमने उस point को intersect किया. वो point कोई ना कोई इन curves पे intersect हो रहा होगा. Okay. जिस curve से intersect होगा, वो आपकी P by FCK की value है.
ठीक है.
राइट नाउ इट इज इंटरसेक्टिंग एट पी बाय एफ सी के ऑफ 1.115. यू कैन ट्राई इट इन योर ओन चार्ट्स. सो यू कैन फाइंड आउट पी परसेंटेज ऑफ स्टील, दैट इज 0.115 इंटू 25, विच इज 2.875%. सो अकॉर्डिंग टू द गिवन लोड्स यू हैव टू प्रोवाइड 2.875% ऑफ स्टील. दैट्स इट. सो एरिया ऑफ स्टील इज 2.875 ऑफ द ग्रॉस एरिया. 2.875% इंटू 300/400 गिव्स यू 3450. So you have to provide at least 3450 mm square of the steel. We are going to use 8 bars of 25 mm diameter. So AST provided comes out to be 3927 mm square. Okay, we have already seen how to use this graph. We have seen in the axially loaded column how to design lateral ties, which is very easy according to the code. So that's the same thing applies here. And 8 dia at 300 center to center is what you have to give according to the design. You can just refer that. So this is the detailing now. This is 400, 300, 60 ka cover hai. And this is your lateral tie, which is tied one in a diamond shape. So this is your lateral ties. These ties are all at 300 center to center. So har 300 pe you have to put these ties, this square ties also, which is for these corner columns. And har 300 pe you have to put these ties also, which is for these. This is for these bars, okay. So, and their reinforcement is 8 dia, 8 numbers, 25 dia. Okay, the detailing is quite easy. I should have made all these bars at solids. It should not be hollow. So, please take a note that these all bars should be shaded properly. It is a solid bar, not a hollow bar. So in some bars I have not shaded properly. Okay, so next we are going to see biaxial column. Okay, only one moment was there now in uniaxial column. In biaxial column we'll see that moment is going to come from both the directions. Okay, steps are you can refer any book. In that, steps are given that you should, first step is you find this, find that. So you can refer the steps. I'll directly show you that how to apply those steps. Okay, for generally this case arises in a corner column. So this is a corner column. Okay, these are beams coming from both the directions. Now what will happen is this beam will have P in X direction. Let's consider this will have P in Y direction. Now both from both the directions these loads are at a certain eccentricity from the CG of the column. So this will generate in moment in X and this is going to generate a moment in Y. I hope this picture is clear. Okay, a corner column 400 by 400 mm subjected to factored load 1300 kN, moment 190 in X and 110 in Y. Design reinforcement, assuming FCK 25, FY 415, cover is 60, and it is given that it is a short column, so you need not to check. Agar nahi diya hota ki short column hai, to aapko L by least lateral dimension ko 12 se kam hai ki nahi, wo check karna padta. So these are the given thing. Now, in this first, we are going to fix a trial reinforcement. And how do we do that again? We'll find PU by FCK BD because again we have to use those charts. Okay. So PU by FCK BD is 1300 into 1000 divided by 25 into 400 into 400, which is 0.325. Now, as you have two moments right now, so according to the code, this is you do 1.15 times of MU X square and MU Y square to find MU. Okay. So you did 190, 110 square under root into 1.15 gives you 252.5. This is your moment. Now, as you know your final moment, you can find MU by FCKBD square. So, MU is 252.5 into 10 raised to power of 6 divided by FCK is 25 and this is 400 by 400, 0.158. D dash by D is 60 by 400. Again, you have to use 0.15 is your D dash by D. So, this is again the same chart which we used in previous question. We refer SP16. We'll refer in the same way. Okay. That we'll go for hum x axis pe 0.325 dekhenge, y axis pe 0.158 dekhenge, dono ko intersect karenge, jis curve pe wo intersect hoga, wo curve hamara p by fck ka hoga, that is 0.145 in this case. So your percentage of steel comes out to be 0.145 into 25, which is 3.625, which is okay over here because theoretically it's okay, practically you should restrain to 2.5. Okay, so 0.365 is the percentage of steel. So we can find out the area of steel. 3.625 into 400, which is 5800 mm square. Mm square should be the area of steel which has to you have to provide. So you will use 12 bars of 25 mm dia, which is going to suffice this area. So 12 bars of 25 mm dia comes out to be 4890, which is greater than 5890. Which is greater than 5800, hence you can provide that. Now, as you have provided 5890, we'll see what is the actual percentage of steel, which is 3.68. Okay, so you will again find P by FCK is 0.147. So we'll go for finding MUX1 for this percentage of steel, which is 3.68. तो अब हम 0.147 का ग्राफ पकड़ेंगे और PU by FCK BD को 0.325 पकड़ेंगे और MUX1 की वैल्यू फाइंड करेंगे फ्रॉम चार्ट. ओके, सो वील गो फ्रॉम द एक्स एक्सिस PU by FCK BD विल कोइंसाइड विद द ग्राफ ऑफ 0.147 एंड विल सी ऑन द वाई ऑन द सॉरी विल गो फ्रॉम वाई एक्सिस फाइंडिंग PU by FCK BD 0.325 कोइंसाइड विद द कर्व ऑफ 0.147 and move in the towards the x-axis and find out that MUX1 by FCK BD square is 0.16. So your MUX1 is 256. Okay. This is the graph we used. Similarly, we'll go for MUY1 as everything is same in both directions. MUY is also 256. Then we'll find PUZ. PUZ is total amount of axial force which is going to which is your column is going to carry. Because right now your area of steel required and provided was different. Okay, so required was 5800, I guess, and you provided 5890. So your PUZ is going to change instead of that. So AC is 400 into 5890, and when you calculate it, you find out that your PUZ comes around 3567. Okay. So, original PU upon PUZ, 1300 upon 3567 is 0.367. Okay. So, this is the formula which we have to check for. The resistance of members subjected to axial force and biaxial bending shall be obtained on the basis of assumptions given in 39.1 and 2. That is fine. Alternatively, such members may be designed for the following equation. You have to suffice this equation, that is MUX, MUX1. MUY, MUY1 shall be less than 1. We know all the moments. Design moment is MUX, MUY, and X1 and Y1 is the moment which we calculated from the acquired percentage of steel later. Now, we also calculated PUZ for the provided steel and PU was our given load. So, for the ratio is alpha N. Now, how do we find out alpha N when we know PU by PUZ? For values of PU by PUZ 0.82 to 0.8, that is R is between 0.3 something, we have to interpolate 0.2 ke liye 1 and 0.8 ke liye 2. So, we'll interpolate between them. So, when we interpolated, we found out to be 1.273 of alpha. So, now you know everything in this equation. MUX, MUY is the design moment of 190 and 110. MUX1 is the obtained moment after that your percentage of steel can take this much of moment, which is 256. Alpha is 1.273, which comes out to be around 1.025, which is greater than 1, but it is very slightly greater than 1. So, we'll consider it. And otherwise, we should have done two things. Either if we have to take it on the lower side of 1, we would have increased percentage of steel or increased the section size. Okay, but it is very less, so we can consider it right now. If it is like around 1, if this decimal of 0 changes, then we should definitely design it again. It should be less than 1 for the safety, of course. So, right now, if we consider 1.025, we'll say that our values and equations suffice this interaction formula. And so, we may accept this design. Okay. So, we have provided these bars of using 8 diode, 300 center to center lateral ties. The design of lateral ties is same as we designed in the actually loaded column. we are using 12 bars of 25 mm dia equally distributed on all four sides. 60 is the cover, and 8 dia at 300 center to center. Okay, so this was the end of our discussion, which we discussed all three columns. How are we going to design all the three columns of which are axially loaded, uniaxial and biaxial columns. You must follow these design steps, and you should refer any book and design a number of times, and do let me know if you have any queries. So with the queries we can discuss more. And this lecture was delivered by Anjuri Shrivastava, Assistant Professor, Civil Engineering Department, IPS Academy, Institute of Engineering and Science. Thank you. Have a nice day.